my brain is like, hey, you're okay. And my body's like, fuck you, dude. And I'm like, no, you're okay. We're really okay. It's not that bad. And my body's like... What is good, YouTube? It's your girl, Gracesandra, and I'm back today to talk about anxiety. On this channel, I give mental health hacks, and a lot of them are coming straight from suffering from this ish myself. Anxiety is something that has ruined my thoughts, my plans, my moods, my relationships, my situations, jobs. Anxiety is a self-esteem killer, and anxiety lies to us. Straight up lies. If you're new here, my name is Gracesandra. I'm a writer, a mom, and an advocate, and I talk a lot about mental health, complex PTSD, and being a woman healing from multiple traumas. If you're not, please subscribe. So in this brief video, I want to give us just a few things that have really, really, really helped me deal with anxiety, and just a little bit of my backstory. So as I said, I'm someone who dealt with multiple traumas growing up. I knew that I suffered from chronic depression. It was very, very obvious to me. From 14 years old on, I was just dealing with so much depression on and off. I had a lot of family trauma, and that family trauma extended until I moved out of my house when I was 22 or 23 years old. That depression carried over into my marriage and into having babies, but I didn't really think of myself as an anxious person. I had a friend growing up who always told me that she was having panic attacks, and I didn't know what that meant, what that was. To be honest with you, I was kind of a little jerk, and I remember gaslighting her and being like, really? Like, are you really having panic attacks? Like, okay. This was when I was a young teenager, like 13, 14, 15, so have mercy on my soul, please. When I myself had to eat the cake, anime, eat the cake, is when I realized that I too was having panic attacks. So anxiety for me started in earnest, that I really understood when it started, was when I married a narcissistically abusive man. He started that with increasing intensity verbal abuse. And when I recognized the first time that I was having what might be called an anxiety attack, while I was pregnant, he was having an emotional affair with a couple different women. And I caught him in one of the situations where he had taken out this woman on a date. And instead of just telling me like, yeah, I took her on a date, nothing happened, we went to the movies, I think they might have went out to dinner, instead of just telling me that, he lied about it for the next 6 months as I continued to find like evidence and find text messages and find all of this stuff. Because you know, when you a woman trying to find out what your husband doing, you can't stop, you become freaking Inspector Gadget. And the more stuff I found out, the more I wondered, is it this? Because he was still saying,
nothing ever happened, no, never met her, never saw her, never talked to her.
I didn't know whether or not they were in love, whether or not they were sleeping together. I just didn't know. So it was increasing my anxiety. I was pregnant also. One of my friends suggested I get one of those spy on your text messages things. Before you think I'm completely off my rocker, he actually agreed to it. He let me plug his phone into this app on my computer where I could see all of his text messages ever from that phone, which was about a year and a half old. I don't know why he was that confident in himself. Maybe he just didn't care anymore. But once I saw those text messages of them saying, hey, let's meet up at Cinema 10 on April 24th or whatever date it was that I knew that he had been missing and I didn't know where he was. And I remember the feeling of not being able to breathe, feeling like that, just an asphyxiation, like I couldn't grasp for air hard enough. I remember feeling an overwhelming sense of, what does this mean? What's gonna happen? What about my family? What about this baby? All in a very small amount of time. The way I like to describe a panic attack is like everything you're worried about as a whole, as a weight, in, you know, 2 seconds, 3 seconds, 4 seconds. And so those seconds feel very, very intense. It's not like a normal worry. A good example to me of the opposite is, for those of you who are parents, you know, we worry about our kids, different scenarios they're in. We worry about, I hope they're okay at school, I hope they have a good life, we pray that they're protected. So the times that I have those worrying fears about my kids, for example, I might have it, drop them off at school, I might have a quick thought, oh, I hope they're okay today. Later on, I hope my son doesn't get hurt at football practice, etc. So that's two times out of one day that I might have like what could be considered a worrying thought. But when someone is going through a panic attack or an anxiety attack, you're having maybe 100 worrying thoughts in 1 or 2 seconds, and the intensity like literally takes your breath away. So that's when I first registered, I'm having anxiety. He had already started verbally abusing me really bad during that time, and a function of that verbal abuse was how he was trying to tear me down about trying to look into these emotional affairs, because he just didn't want me to find out. So I guess he thought he could intimidate me. Well, he did tell me this later, because I was like, why were you so mean to me about it if you had actually done it? And he said,
I was trying to just shake you off the trail by intimidating you.
He didn't use those exact words, but essentially from then on, our marriage became just increasing increasingly abusive in a multitude of ways. I realized in about a year or so that my anxiety was through the roof. And then I went to a therapist and I got diagnosed with complex PTSD. And a big function of PTSD is anxiety. So this looks so different for everybody, but for me, it really looked like just complete and utter inability to handle stress. Stress of all sorts was pulling me down in a way that I had never experienced before and really have never experienced before, because that was one of the lowest times of my life in terms of being in a concentrated state of stress and trauma with someone who was supposed to love me. If you've ever been narcissistically abused, it produces a tremendous amount of confusion and cognitive dissonance, and cognitive dissonance is what happens in your body, what makes you sick, and it makes your brain sick too. So I started isolating from people and isolating from friends. I didn't want to tell anyone how bad things were. That was one function of my anxiety. I was so scared when I went out, someone would ask me how I was, and I always had tears forming in the back of my eyes for a couple years. It killed my productivity. Having that much anxiety, it was so hard to do anything. And y'all, it's still so hard for me to do a lot of stuff. That's one way that this has really carried on. Another thing is just like wasting time, because when you're trying to escape these anxious thoughts and not productively, you just waste so much time. I always felt like, am I safe here? Am I safe here? Am I safe in this moment? If you've ever lived with someone with a mental illness, an abuser, or intimate partner violence in any way, you know that that walking on eggshell feeling is hard to get rid of even when you're somewhere else. So when I was at work, I always felt perpetually unsafe. Ended up having to leave that job because there was so much high stress, police presence every day, a lot of people who were houseless and or drug addicts and things like that would come into the facility that I was working and just act a whole ass hot fool. And I just couldn't bear that. It would give me the most severe anxiety attacks. I would be shaking and I'd have to go into the back and I'd have to be away from the patrons because I just couldn't handle it. That's fairly new. You know, I grew up in the hood. I grew up seeing a lot of violence. I grew up experiencing myself a lot of violence at the hands of my brother, at the hands of my father, and the neighborhood in general, men in general. It's not like I don't know how to be around very stressful, high intense situations, but during this marriage, in the process of leaving especially, and when he actually left, my anxiety was so through the roof that I could barely handle someone, you know, going like that next to me. I would be like and just be so scared all the time. Another thing that might be happening to you if you suffer from some forms of anxiety is this feeling of I'll never get the job I love, I'll never amount to anything, etc. The other statement, I'm just good for nothing, I'm just this, I'm just that. So how it affects the way that we talk about ourselves is really, really salient, and it's something that can just drag you down. So let me talk about what has helped me a ton, especially when I was trauma bonded to my ex and he moved out. That was the time where my anxiety, like I said, was through the roof. So what has really, really helped me? These are my best practices. If these don't work, try other things, because again, different things work for different people. You have to try to know. So the first thing that I started doing was just deep breathing. So in the moment when I was at my job, if I was freaked out by some random dude who was acting a fool, I would just start. I did try the 4 in, 4 out, pause 4. So that was one thing I would just do over and over again. And let me tell y'all, there were days where I was doing this literally all day. My anxiety was so bad, I was deep breathing in and out all day, trying to calm myself down. Basically, what it tells your body when you're able to deep breathe that much, it tells your body you're safe. When a human body is not safe, it's very, very difficult to achieve physical equilibrium. So consider if you're on a plane and you know the plane is going down and you've got a minute left to live. It would be extremely difficult to do calming deep breaths and have your whole body just remain calm. You'd have to be freaking Deepak Chopra, because when we're in danger, our adrenaline has kicked up. It's producing synapses in our brain that are telling you're in danger, you're in danger, you need to do this, you need to do that. And having anxiety is like feeling like you're always in danger. When you deep breathe like that, your body is like, okay. It's almost like your mind thinking I'm in danger, but your body saying, despite what you're thinking, I'm all right. So I'm just gonna go ahead and calm down. Because humans, unfortunately, we're the only animal that can convince our bodies that we're in danger even when we're not. That's why people get PTSD from trauma that happened in the past, because our minds are still stuck in that moment, and so then our body responds. So deep diaphragmatic breathing. If you're new to diaphragmatic breathing, not just deep breathing, but diaphragmatic, go to YouTube and look up diaphragmatic breathing and do some guided exercises with other people, then you'll learn it and get used to it. It took me probably, you know, 5 or 6 months to really get used to doing it in a way that my body was like, okay, I really can calm down. Cause y'all, the thing is, you might be like me where sometimes my body is freaking out, adrenaline and cortisol have spiked, and my brain is like, hey, you're okay. And my body's like, fuck you, dude. And I'm like, no, you're okay. We're really okay. It's not that bad. And my body's like, another thing that I have tried that's really helped well for me is chanting things that are meaningful to you. One of them that's worked well for me is all is well, all shall be well, all is well, all shall be well, all is well, all shall be well. I'm doing it fast, but I would probably do it slower. Sometimes I have done it fast, especially if I'm really revved up. This is very much in line with it, but breath prayers, and that's breathing in a phrase and breathing out a phrase. So inhaling, Abba Father, outhaling, I am yours. Inhaling, Abba Father, outhaling, exhaling. Exhaling, I am yours, not outhaling. Another thing that has really helped me is interrupting it. So interrupting a high anxiety moment by just doing something very different very quickly. And it's really hard to do this, y'all. The motivation to do this is so low when you're having anxiety attack, but it is a habit and a ritual that you can get used to. Some people snap themselves with rubber bands. Some people hold ice. There's different things that people do. I don't like hurting myself like that. So what I've done is kind of try to force myself to go outside. Even if it's cold, even if it's really hot, not if it's raining, but if I can go outside, especially if I can like put my feet in sand or dirt or walk on grass and just ground with the earth, I know it sounds weird and freaky, but it actually does work because the energy of the earth like matches the energy in our body and it helps it regulate. And that's just how God made us. It's not woo-woo, it's science. That's just how we're made. Being outside is calming. That's why when we're in front of the sun and it gives us vitamin D, we feel better because our bodies need vitamin D. It's the same thing, y'all. So I interrupt the signal by getting outside, especially on the days where I'm having so much anxiety and I'm with my kids and I'm like, let's just go outside, we're going to the park, we're going to the beach, and I'm almost like mad when I'm saying it, and they can probably tell and feel my energy that I'm mad, I'm frustrated, I'm angry. And then I get to wherever we're going and I'm like, oh, isn't this great, kids? And they're like,
Mom was just literally in a terrible mood.
I try really hard to hide this from my kids. I have told them before, I'm having an anxiety attack. My older kids are 12 and 16, so I have told them. Reaching out to people. What I usually do if I'm having a really bad anxiety attack, I actually reach out to them through voice clip. I either leave a voice clip on Messenger or Voxer or via the text app or via iPhone Messenger, because then I don't have to actually talk to them. Because if you're like me, you want to isolate when you're feeling super anxious. But I actually have reached out for help. And I'll say, hey, I'm having a really rough day mental health wise. I could really use your prayers. If you get a minute, message me back. And I'll just be honest. Thankfully, I have friends who know my situation, so I'll just be honest. Like, hey,
I don't really feel like talking, but I would love to hear back from you. How are you? How's your life?
Just reaching out to another human, even though I haven't actually spoken with them, is like top tier tip of mine to deal with anxiety. And then above that, the highest, best way to deal with anxiety is to be around someone you love as soon as you can, and someone who feels safe, and get a hug from them and make it last for 30 seconds. Just be like,
hey, listen, I need to hug you for at least 30 seconds. I know this might seem weird.
I have done that to so many people in my life. Y'all would be like, Grace, oh my God, I swear to God. There's a few girls that I supervised at work who I got really close to. So I was like, can you hug me for 30 seconds? And I would just stand there. And then a few times I started crying. With my kids, I don't tell them that's what I'm doing. I'll just be like, hey, come give me a hug, you know, and I'll just hug them kind of from the side, but I'll hold it a little bit longer because I don't want them to know like I'm getting emotional support from you, because I just really don't think that's a healthy dynamic. But I do kind of get the hug aspect from them. If I'm in a terrible mood and I happen to be around some of my close friends and I get a hug from them, it just really lifts the anxiety. It's the boost I need like nothing else. So figure out what that is for you. I have a kitten meowing in the background. Sorry for the noise. They're like 6 weeks old. Last suggestion for dealing with anxiety is use the tapping app. I think it's called, let me look here. Actually, I don't need to look. It's called the Tapping Solution. I think it's like $8.99 a month. This is not sponsored. This is just something I use and love. It walks you through guided meditations where you're tapping on pressure points of your body. And apparently, like, I don't know all of the science behind it. All I can tell y'all is it helps. It does something in your body that helps your body calm down. And it really helps. I mean, I love tapping. I'm going to link a few books below for resources on tapping, some books that I would recommend. Those are Amazon affiliate links. It's no extra cost to you, but gives me a little kickback. Thank you so much for watching, and I pray that your anxiety journey continues to get better, like mine is, continues to feel more and more safe in this world. If you want to learn more about anxiety, you might want to watch this video next.